joy and peace to all the people of the earth. Let's receive the word of God with Reverend Kiluba or Kiluba. May God bless you.
I want to run where the angels have tried.
Dear online listeners, and dear listeners who follow us on your local radios of your respective cities, among the nations of the earth, I'd love to greet you in the name of the hour that is feared. Welcome to the hour that is feared by the great prostitute who is seated on the great waters. An hour that she fears, together with all the power of darkness. I want to greet you in the name of the hour that the power of darkness fears. Behold, hell is shaking, for the Holy Spirit is here. It's here. It is the day that the devil fears and the powers of darkness fear. The hour. I would love that this hour should come to your church, to your family, to your ministry, to your nation. May this hour may sound again and again. There are things that the powers of darkness do not fear, but I've greeted you in the name of the hour that Satan himself fears. He knows. The Bible says, in the hour of the power that I'm talking to you about today, an angel came down with authority and his glory illuminated the earth, and he cried out, "Fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great." 1 hour was enough so that the great city, opulent city, should be cast down. 1 hour. 1 hour. 1 hour was enough so that the great, powerful city and opulent city, no matter the power of the great prostitute, she is a powerful, but she fears an hour. There's an hour she fears. She knows what I'm telling you. She knows. One hour is enough. I'll come to that. I believe that this message will change many things. I love to say to many people, the great men of God, they know what I'm talking about. We know pastors, we need pastors, evangelists, men and women who have a great respect for the hour. The great and dreadful hour. Receive this revelation. 1 hour was enough in order to deal with the powers of darkness. Deal with them. Deal with the global power of darkness, like the great prostitute who was seated on the great waters, who are the nations, the people, the tribes. She fell in 1 hour. And Jesus said in Gethsemane, what did Jesus go to do in Gethsemane? He went to respect this message, which is not liked by the great prostitute and the powers of darkness, and they are allied agents. I would love to invite you to the hour. Jesus knew that the cross was before him, and therefore he needed to go and do this work. For 1 hour, I would have to ask apostles, pastors, evangelists, teachers of the churches. Having ministry is one thing, but you need to learn the lesson of the hour of Gethsemane. Jesus did this. If we do it, we are following his footsteps. He said to the apostles, "You are sleeping. You could not watch with me just for 1 hour. Just for 1 hour. Hallelujah. Why did Jesus speak about 1 hour? Not two, not three. 1 hour of prayer. In Revelation 18, the Bible says 1 hour was enough. I am inviting you to the hour of the business of God. Hallelujah. If you want to do business with God, respect the hour. That's why I greeted you in the name of the hour that is dreaded by hell. It is the hour of threats against threats. The Bible says when we turn our gazes to you, Our faces are not covered with shame. We shine with joy, and we are delivered from fear. There are things that scare you. In Gethsemane, Jesus began to feel affliction and sorrow and fear. But this message, the hour was there, and he respected the hour. Not only he respected the hour, but he also spoke to his co-workers, watch and pray. He says, you are sleeping. You could not watch with me just for 1 hour. 1 hour. He knew that the great prostitute was going to drink of blood. So Jesus said to those who came to arrest him, he says, if you have come to arrest me, let this go. Jesus knew that the great prostitute was here to be able to kill not only Jesus, but also the partners of Jesus. It is written in Revelation 17 that the great prostitute is filled with the blood of the witnesses of Jesus. Jesus knew that the great prostitute was before what she loves to shed the blood of the witnesses. I want to say to the people of the earth that holiness exposes you to death. The great prostitute was filled with the blood of the saints, of the saints and the witnesses of Jesus. But Jesus prayed for his co-workers. Even himself could not be arrested. He gave himself willingly so that the world may be saved. And he preserved the life of the witnesses of Christ. If it wasn't for the prayer of Jesus, the witnesses were going to be butchered. He knew the intentions of the great prostitute who seated on the great waters, and that's why he said, if it's me who you're asking for, take me, let this go. His blood was supposed to be shed so that your blood may be preserved, in order for you to be a witness of Christ, not for useless things. Kiluba lives in order to be a witness of Christ. Jesus says, let this go. He said to them, wait in Jerusalem until you are clothed with power, and you will be my witnesses. But he knew that these witnesses were the target of the great prostitute, and he prayed. The hour of prayer is the time when the demons are made to obey by force. Revelation 18 verse 10, they cried out, woo woo, Babylon the Great, in 1 hour has come your judgment. What was this hour? Look at verse 19. They threw dust on their heads and cried out, weeping and wailing, and saying, alas, alas, the great city in which all had ships on the sea became rich by her wealth. For in 1 hour she is made desolate. Hallelujah, hallelujah. 1 hour. That is why I greeted you in the name of the hour that is dreaded by the great prostitute. In 1 hour. 1 hour. 1 hour. 1 hour. She is desolate, destroyed. Now you understand why Jesus insisted for the apostles to pray with him in 1 hour. He had a good vision in 1 hour. Verse 20, rejoice over her, O heaven, and you holy apostles and prophets, for God has avenged you on her. Then a mighty angel took up a stone like a great millstone and threw it into the sea, saying, thus with violence the great city Babylon shall be thrown down and shall not be found anymore. Hey. 1 hour was enough in order to make this powerful city to disappear. That is why I greeted you today, dear faithful listeners among the nations. I greeted you in the name that I know, in the name of the hour that destroys this woman who hates you. Jesus says, if the world hates you, know that it hated me first. The hatred that the great prostitute has against Jesus, He said it's not good for a prophet to die out of Jerusalem. She was waiting for Jesus in Jerusalem. It is the same hatred that Babylon has for all the saints and all the witnesses. Many believers think that being holy is a good thing to go to heaven. Yes, no one will enter the kingdom without holiness. But before you go to heaven, your holiness will attract you battles, because Babylon was filled with the blood of the saints and the witnesses of Christ. We live in a time where people use teaching in order to be famous, to be glorious, to be visible online. But I want you to know that being a witness of Christ, it is going to attract you to be condemned to death by the great prostitute Babylon. She doesn't want us to speak of Jesus. I will always speak about Jesus, because the Holy Spirit speaks about Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I say to the Pentecostals, Satan hates you and he wants to kill you. You churches of revival, if he doesn't kill you physically, he will kill you spiritually with sin. Why? Because you have received the Holy Spirit in order to be witnesses of Christ. She knows who you are and she does not stand that. You can speak about politics, you have problems with politicians, but if you speak about Jesus, you are going to have to deal with a death sentence from Babylon, who kills the witnesses of Jesus. But 1 hour is enough that I'm going to share with you. 1 hour is enough in order to deal with the cruelty and the wickedness and the death of great Babylon. Behold the message I'll share with you today. The hour of power against power. Hallelujah. I will speak to you about the hour of power against power. Hallelujah. This is the topic we're going to speak about today, with the help of the faithful companion, the Holy Spirit. Let's go to our theme scripture, the hour of power against power. Hallelujah. When Jesus was calling the apostles to watch with him for 1 hour, he knew that the woman who's called, the great, powerful, and opulent city, was there. He did not name it. He named it to his apostle in Revelation. But in Luke, he said, this is your hour, the hour of the power of darkness. He knew. Gethsemane. I invite the brothers and sisters, the churches of the earth, to Gethsemane. Come back. And it is here that Jesus was going to fight. What is the hour of power? It is prayer. That's what the hour of power is. It is prayer. The hour of power is prayer. That is what the hour of power against power. Gethsemane. It was the hour of prayer. The hour of prayer against the powers of darkness. That's what the hour of power is. It is not 1 p.m. or 12 p.m. or 5 a.m. The hour of power is prayer. I will try to show you this through the scriptures, so that I may carry the church of Christ into Gethsemane. The hour of power is prayer. The hour of power against power is prayer. We don't need power to do shows. No. We need power against power. Isaiah 41 verse 25. It is God who says it. God has a good vision of prayer. I call him from the north. He comes from the east. He crushes as one who crushes pots of clay. Have a good vision of prayer. Have God's vision of prayer. I would love to baptize every one of you in the vision of God with regards to prayer. I called him from the north. He came instead of the east. Put Johannesburg, put Montreal, put Port Noir, put Tel Aviv, put Cape Town, put Johannesburg, put your city. For Jesus, it was in Gethsemane where the power came from. It says, I called him from the east. It doesn't matter if you're in Africa. It doesn't matter if you're in America. It doesn't matter if you're in Asia. It doesn't matter if you're in Europe. It doesn't matter if you are in the islands. May you call him. Today I am challenging you. May you call on him. I have called him from the east. Call him from your room. He calls my name and he receives the power that crushes power. Isaiah 41:25. I have raised up one from the north and he shall come from the rising of the sun. No matter the place where you are, may you call him. His power is there. Psalms 150:1. Praise him in his mighty firmament. I am saying to you, may you call him in all the earth where his power is made manifest. It will explode. The hour of power is prayer. Nothing more, nothing less. Prayer is the hour of power against power. That is what I've read. Isaiah 41:25. I have raised up one from the north, and he shall come from the rising of the sun. He shall call on my name, and he shall come against princes as though mortar, as the potter treads clay. Honor to the men of prayer. If the Apostle Peter says honor to those who believe, I say honor to the men and women of prayer because they crush the powers. You know, there are people who don't love prayer. Intercession means nothing to them. I want to say to all the believers who do not pray, you are sinners even though you keep all the commandments. If you do not intercede, you are sinners. Some people say, Kiluba, you are exaggerating with the gospel. It is not me who sang it. 1 Samuel 7:7-9. Now when the Philistines heard that the children of Israel had gathered together at Mizpah, the lords of the Philistines went up against Israel. And when the children of Israel heard of it, they were afraid of the Philistines. So children of Israel said to Samuel, do not cease to cry out to the Lord, our God, for us, that he may save us from the hand of the Philistines. And Samuel took a suckling lamb and offered it as a whole burnt offering to the Lord. Then Samuel cried out to the Lord for Israel, and the Lord answered him. Now as Samuel was offering up the burnt offering, the Philistines drew near to battle against Israel, but the Lord thundered with a loud thunder upon the Philistines that day, and so confused them that they were overcome before Israel. Samuel also said, he says, I will not sin by not praying for you in this day of our weekly message. May you have a good vision of prayer. It will make you powerful. I called him from the east. He shall call my name. He crushes the powerful. May you become powerful to crush the powerful. The hour of power against power, which is the hour of prayer. Jesus became powerful in prayer and word at the hour of prayer. Luke 24:19. The two disciples of Emmaus speak of Jesus and say he was a prophet, powerful in word and in works. He became powerful in order to crush. And Jesus became that in the hour of prayer. Luke chapter 4. I want to make clear the principle of prayer. The Holy Spirit led Jesus to the room of prayer so that it should be powerful. Luke 4:1. Then Jesus, being filled with the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to do what? To fast and pray.
Jésus revêtu de puissance, de la puissance de l'Esprit, retourna en Galilée, sa renommée se répandit.
Now when the devil had ended the temptation, he departed from him until an opportune time. Then Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit of Galilee, and news of him went through all the surrounding region, and he taught in their synagogues, being glorified by all. Jesus, the Holy Spirit led Jesus in the hour of power against power by prayer. May you be led into prayer for you to be powerful, to crush the powerful. Jesus learned this. He became powerful because he went in the desert to pray. Satan is intelligent. I believe the church falls in the same trap of the devil so that they may be turned away from prayer as he tried to do the same to Jesus. The church is filled with men and women who spend their times to pray and fast for accessory things. Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but from everything that comes from the mouth of God. The devil wanted to lead Jesus in legitimate needs, but that accessory needs. There are many prayers that are not the arrow of power against power. You are praying for accessory things. May you have a good vision of your prayer. The main important thing about prayer, it is a power against power. There are people who enter in prayer like the Holy Spirit led Jesus in prayer. Because the Holy Spirit wanted to clothe Jesus with power, but Satan, clever as he was, he wanted to turn Jesus away in his prayer so that Jesus may begin to seek for bread through his prayer. But Jesus avoided Satan. It is not that Jesus did not need bread, he was hungry. He did not pretend to not be hungry and saying, I'm not hungry. He knew that it was a true need that was there. Because Jesus was hungry when Satan began to tempt him. Satan was trying to turn away Jesus from the main need so that he may look for the accessory need. Jesus resisted Satan. In the Bible, it's full of these things. And Satan proposed to Jesus glory, kingdom. But Jesus remained in what I'm teaching today. The purpose of his presence in the desert. Hallelujah. I'm thinking about the presence of Israel in the desert who were saved from Egypt. What was the purpose of Israel in the desert? It was Mount Sinai. God was going to give to Israel the power of fire. In a few days, you are going to be baptized in fire, clothed with power. The purpose of the valley of the shadow of death, it was power. After the valley, you set a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. After that, he had power to crush the enemies. I would love that you should end your change your obsessions in prayer. Not only did Jesus learn this, in his journey in the desert, from where came the power to crush the devil? The devil feels crushed. The devil feels crushed and left him. And then began the itinerary of power. Hallelujah and hallelujah. He went from place to place. You know how God anointed Jesus with spirit and power. He was strong and powerful. Hallelujah. An itinerary of power. I feel that. I'd love that you should be clothed with power so that wherever you go, the power will explode. The power explodes in the firmament of praise. It exploded in Cana. It is the power that created the best wine. Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the work thy hand hath made. I see the stars. I hear the roaring thunder. Thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my song, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
In a village, the power exploded. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The power is where you are. praise him in his mighty firmament. From the desert he didn't leave naked, but he left clothed with power, because he respected the hour of power against power in his prayer, in his prayer. And Jesus taught this in Mark 9, verse
18. L'enfant équime, grince des dents, devant tout, devient tout raide. J'ai prié tes disciples de chasser l'esprit.
I asked your disciples to cast out the spirit, but they couldn't.
Vous supporterez, amenez-le-moi. On les lui amena.
And Jesus said, bring him to me. And when the child saw Jesus, immediately the spirit convulsed him, and he fell on the ground and wallowed foaming at the mouth. So he asked his father, how long has this been happening to you? And he said, from childhood. And he often has thrown him into both fire and to water, destroy him. But if you can do anything, have compassion, ask and help us. Jesus said to him, if you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. Immediately the father of the child cried out and said with tears, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. When Jesus saw the people running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to him, deaf and dumb spirit, I command you, come out of him and enter him no more. Then the spirit cried out, convulsed him incredibly, and came out of him, and he became as one dead, so that many say he is dead. But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up and arose. And when he had come into the house, his disciples asked privately, why could we have not cast him out? So he said to them, this kind can come out by nothing but prayer and fasting. Hallelujah and hallelujah. May you throw out the unclean spirits that are tormenting your cities. Throw them out of your cities. Spirits that are throwing people into death, may you cast them out, because this kind can come out by nothing but prayer and fasting. May you take out the mountain demons of your cities, the hour of power against power. This was Mark 9:18-29. Isaiah 41:15. I will make you a sharp instrument. You are going to crush the mountains. You are going to crush the hill, and the wind will take them away. But you will rejoice in the Lord.
Verse 25.
I have raised up one from the north. He shall come from the rising of the sun. He shall call on my name. He shall come against princes as though mortar, as the potter treads clay. These are mountains who are crushed because of the one who was calling upon the name of the Lord from the east. And Jesus says here, this kind of demon, that is mountain demon, can only live by fasting and prayer. May you receive power against power by the hour of prayer. Thanks be to the hour of prayer. I love the song that says, if you believe and I believe, together we'll pray, the Holy Spirit must come down, Africa will be saved. The hour of prayer, the hour of prayer will deal with the powers of darkness. I'm thinking of John, who was a man of fasting and prayer. He fasted by his lifestyle, his fashion. He only wore a mantle made of animal skin. Even his diet, he only ate wild honey and locusts. And he lived in the desert until the day he was presented to the public. May you follow the men of God in their places of prayer. You will become like them. John the Baptist was this kind. When he came from the desert, he took care of the mountains. He says, I'm the voice who cries in the desert. May you live with the mountains. May you live with the hills. May you exhaust the valleys, and the glory of God shall appear. And Jesus, who went to John the Baptist, also began from the desert. May you go to the east. May you go to the place of prayer. Let it be in the room or in the desert. The power that Christ, the power of the world did not come from the desert of the apostles. It came from the upper room of the apostles. Enter in your rooms. What is important is the hour of prayer. May you enter in the presence of power, and you are going to be powerful beings. The hour of power against power is prayer. This was the life of John the Baptist, and he burnt down the mountains. You are going to become powerful beings who are going to crush powers. Jesus came out of the desert clothed with power, and he was shaking the powers of darkness. Matthew 24. I would love truly that this message should make of you powerful beings for power. Matthew 24, verse 29. Immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from heaven and the powers of heavens will be shaken. Who is shaking them? Verse 30. Then the Son of Man will appear in the heaven, and then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. Hallelujah. The presence of the presence of the Almighty Power is what shakes all things. This was the life of Jesus. And it came from the desert. The power is here, but it's waiting for its activation. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 14. Therefore I bow my knees before the Father in heaven, from whom all the families on earth take their names. And then verse 20 of Ephesians 3. Now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we can ask or think, in all the generations be glory and power unto him. Amen. Don't allow the power to sleep in you. Activate it by prayer. Here the Apostle Paul is activating it by prayer. I bow my knees before the Father. Our Father. Our Father. May you call the Father of power. And he is going to come. The Apostle Paul began in prayer on his knees, and he ended in verse 20 in power. Now unto him was able to do exceedingly. May power become active now. If you're not seeing power, you start seeing power now, my sister. You will begin to see power. You will begin to see power at work when you bow on your knees. Now unto him who is able. He's available to do, but he's able to do by the power in you. Paul just needed to bow on his knees. The hour of power against power. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Is available in every generation. I'm thinking of the revival churches. How was power activated? They began with prayer cells. It was prayer groups that activated power. Church of revivals. Don't you know that my teaching is true? The Pentecostal power that you have did not come from the Bible schools. It came from the prayer groups. In the 1920s, what Paul is speaking about, you experienced it. You charismatic churches, either Catholic or churches of revival, and I'm speaking to the churches that came, the generation that came after the church of revival. Go back to where they began, and you are going to experience. Leave these who are running after politics and go into prayer. Even those politicians you're running to, they also need the hour of prayer. That is what the Apostle Paul is saying to Timothy. He says, first of all, make prayers and intercession for all men, for the kings and all who are lifted in authority. The politicians need prayer. Far from me to sin with regards to not praying for the politicians. And the Apostle Paul is speaking about prayer. In Ephesians 6, verse 18 to 20, the Apostle Paul was teaching power by prayer. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Fortifiez-vous dans le Seigneur par sa force et toute
Ephesians 6 verse 10, finally my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Verse 18, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. May you come back to the hour of power against power by prayer. Be strong in his almighty power. It is by prayer. Paul and John, they made the lamb to walk. It is in the hour of prayer. Let's read.
Pierre et Jean montaient ensemble au temple.
Acts 3 verse 1. Now Peter and John went up together to the temple at the hour of prayer, the ninth hour. Verse 12. So when Peter saw it, he responded to the people, men of Israel, why do you marvel at this? Or why look so intently at us, as though by our own power or godliness we had made this man walk? They went to the temple in the hour of prayer. I say to the believers, may you go to your churches in the hour of power, in the hour of prayer, that you may make to walk the things that are no longer working or walking in your life. May you make to run the things that were no longer running, because you are going to church in the hour of prayer. It will give you power against the power of paralysis. This man was paralyzed in his legs. The upper room birthed a phenomenal power that crushed the powers of darkness. The power that was scattering Jerusalem was crushed by the 120 in prayer. They birthed the power of Pentecost that gathered all the nations and all the tongues. Hallelujah, hallelujah. The hour of prayer is the hour of power against power. In Gethsemane, they were scattered. He says, you leave me all. When they prayed in the upper room, they became powerful and they birthed Pentecost. They did not call upon his name from the east. They called his name from the upper room, and the power was there, and they crushed spiritual death of Jerusalem. And the spiritual lamb of the nations, they were healed. The Bible says they ran to the upper room. May you make your cities to run to the place of prayer. The upper room birthed power against power. In Gethsemane, it says, this is your hour, the hour of the power of the night. And the upper room dealt with that power that scattered them. Dear pastors, may you deal with the power that is scattering you. In Acts 2, it was the first meeting of prayer. In Acts 4, it was a greater gathering of prayer, more than 120, because they were already beyond 3,000. They lifted their voices together from verse 18. And the end result of this prayer, it was power. The place where they were gathered was shaken. Hallelujah and hallelujah. May you gather in prayer in order to make your cities, your continents to shake. May you go on your knees and power will land and your enemies will be crushed. If you go in Acts 5, the Pharisees begin to complain, you have filled our cities with your teachings. May you create crusade seminars by the hour of prayer. It produced in the past, it will produce again. We could speak about Cornelius, who crushed the prejudice of the Jews, who thought that it was only them who had the right to the Holy Spirit. But the angel said to Cornelius, your prayers and offerings have reached the throne of heaven, and his house received the same power that was given to the disciples in the upper room. The prejudice that Eliab had towards David, the prejudice that King Saul had towards David, fell by the power that was on David. The powerful Goliath fell. People will not respect you if you ask them, may you show power, they will respect you. Until next time on the same platform of the gospel, amen. Thank you for following. Let us spread faith all around the world through this teaching.